Hey everybody, welcome to the FBard's Chronicles. This is my channel where I walk you through the adventures of two different groups playing through the Lost Mine of Phandelver. In this episode, I will tell you about the Warhamsters. They had cleared the Cragmaw Castle, rescued their friend Gundren, who is actually not their friend, but a disguised doppelganger. Their real friend is still a captive of the Black Spider. With the doppelgundren, they had returned to Fenelin. I decided that this was the time to dramatically introduce the Red Brands to them. The Red Brands had already been introduced to the other group, the Red Wedge Pact, but the Warhamsters didn't know anything about them. The Warhamsters, upon returning to Phandelin, saw the Red Brands in action. They had a cart loaded with bounty parked outside Barthen's. Two ruffians were standing guard outside, while two others were inside bullying Barthen and extorting money from him. After a little bit of tense and angry parley, the Warhamsters and the Red Brands clashed. The Warhamsters won and managed to take one of the Red Brand women prisoner. Her name was Trelniva. Now remember, the doppelganger Gundren, is with them. He could have revealed himself in this fight, but I decided that let this build up a bit. Such a quick reveal is going to be undramatic and anticlimactic and just overwhelm the players. I'm the kind of DM who is obsessed with things being consistent and having reasons in my fantasy world. So I reason to myself that the doppelgangers are primarily loyal to the Black Spider. They are allied with the Red Brands but don't really care about them. Hence it would be in their best interest to keep quiet and strike when the opportunity is perfect. Of course, you don't need to do any of this. I doubt your players will ever think about it. But for me, it is important that I need to believe in this world if I am to try and make the players believe in this world. The Warhamsters captured Trelniva, tied her up, and tossed her in their room in the inn. They interrogated her for a bit. Krem, the tiefling cleric, played by my friend Ricky, and Keth, the half-orc rogue, played by her husband Dylan, had a bit of a good cop, bad cop moment. It was fun and awesome role-playing. They found out the information that the Red Brands know. Here, I'll put it up on the screen. Having questioned Trelniva, the party decided that they would rest and go talk to Sister Garyle. They had previously met her and decided to take her quest. They were going to go to the ruins of Coneyberry and try to parley with Agatha, the Banshee, and find out what she did with Bogentle's spellbook. It took the players about a day and a half in-game to get to Coneyberry. If your players go for this quest, you better buckle up. You are about to embark in what I believe is the hardest part of DMing. The adventure describes Coneyberry as a haunted, ruined village. Now it's up to us, the DMs, to deliver on that. Which means we have to set the tone. The tone of this place and quest. I find it incredibly hard to set the tone and super easy to lose it. This is the part of DMing that keeps me up at night and makes me super duper anxious. As far as I know, there's really no formula that works for sure. This is how I try to do it. We are playing on Zoom because of the pandemic. First thing I did is I turned off my video. The DM's voice became an omniscient narrator voice. Hearing things that you can't see is already a little unnerving to our psyche. On top of that, I lowered my voice. I literally thought of sad thoughts and made my voice somber. Of course, I described the night to be misty and shrouded in fog. The chilly wind blows up the dry leaves on the ground. The conifers whisper and murmur long forgotten tales. The old dilapidated walls groan and cry out as the chill grasps their ribs. Down the road, you see a couple of translucent, pale children running around, playing. Their lifeless eyes glance in your direction, unfocused, unseeing. The ghost of their last smile still etched across their faces.
You get it. I did my best. They did find Agatha. The players already knew that Agatha is a banshee, so I wanted to use the banshee's wail. I felt that if the players meet a banshee and the banshee doesn't wail at them, then that's a huge letdown. That being said, the banshee's wail ability from the monster manual is crazy powerful. I decided that this is absolutely not going to work. So I changed it to this. Agatha wailed, and I asked everybody to make a wisdom saving throw. Everybody except the cleric failed and got paralyzed. Here's the secret. There was no set DC for the wisdom save. That means there was no set number above which the players had to roll to succeed. I decided on the spot that whoever rolls the highest succeeds and everybody else fails. That way, if the highest roll is 14, then that's the DC. Alternatively, if the highest roll is 18, then perhaps that's the DC. Now, if you are doing this, you need to be careful. This is a tool that needs to be deployed judiciously. You shouldn't do this willy-nilly. I recommend that you can do this once every 4 character levels. Also, you need to really, really believe in the necessity of this before you do it. If you have any doubt, don't do this. Trust me, it's a slippery slope. The flip side is this. If the players all get above a 17, then don't freak them out by saying only the one who got 23 succeeds and everybody else fails. That, I think, sends the wrong message. If they roll very high, just let them succeed. You have to be very careful to make sure that their rolls have weight. The number that they get has meaning. It can't just be whatever the hell you decide. That's bad DMing. So the party is paralyzed except for Krem, the tiefling cleric. This was serendipitous, but perfect. The cleric against undead, while the rest of the party is helpless and paralyzed. Mwah. Shout out to my friend Ricky, by the way, who did some awesome role-playing here with Agatha and managed to get the answers to what she did with Bo Gentle's spellbook. Agatha tells her that her friends will be unparalyzed in an hour and leaves. Now, Krem is in a super delicate position. She is stuck in the middle of a haunted village with 3 paralyzed friends. There's no way that she can carry them all. So she just decides to wait and prays for her turn undead ability to work if need be. A couple of little ghosts are spying on her from behind some walls. She sees them and stares at them, basically kind of glaring at them. The ghosts get braver as she doesn't do anything and come towards her, and Krem moves in front of her friends to protect them. The little ghosts start talking to her and offer to help her move her friends. She asked, "How would you do that?" They promptly answered, "We will possess them and walk them out." Now Ricky, the player, is a mother of 4 adorable kids in real life. So she took her indulgent mom voice and sternly said, "That wouldn't be necessary." The ghosts left, and then the hour passed. I could hear an audible sigh from the 3 players who were paralyzed, and in that moment, I knew that it had worked. They were spooked and had a visceral reaction. The Warhamsters then moved about an hour away from the ruins and decided to camp on a hillside for the night and level up. That's where that session ended. You will get another video this week, and that video will be the story of the Red Wedge Pact. Until next time, that's all, folks.